Welcome to the Startup Grind.
Welcome to Startup Grind. Okay, thanks. Awesome. We at Startup Grind, we usually like to start from the beginning.
Okay.
But not the beginning, like far back when the earth was a formless void. Just from the beginning, like tell us about your background. Where were you born?
Okay, all right. First of all, my full name is Saiwale.
Saiwale?
Yeah.
Okay.
But everyone calls me Wally, it's a historical thing. Yeah. My full name is Saiwale. I'm 40 years old. I'll be 41 in October. I'm the seventh born in my family. Family of four guys and four girls. I was born in Lusaka, UTH. I've got three kids. First one is Rabiana, next one is Yajotani, and then there's my Dolly Joanna, she's here. I went to school, I did the first part of my schooling in Canada, Belgium. My dad was a diplomat. When we came back, I did my secondary school at Kablonga Boys, and when I finished, I went to Copperbelt University.
Okay. Yeah. When did you leave CBU?
Class of 97. Seven.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Awesome. Okay. I went there 2 years after that.
Okay.
Brilliant.
That's why you didn't know me.
Yes. That's why I didn't know you. Brilliant. And initially, you were employed. Tell us about your, like, from CBU, what did you do after that?
Well, I actually went and saw a family friend.
Yeah.
Because I didn't really like the idea of being broke. So I went and saw a family friend, and he offered me a job. So I finished school on Friday. On Monday, I was at work.
Wow.
Yeah, I booked it in advance. Okay. I didn't want to leave stuff to chance. Yeah. I worked there for just a couple of months. Yeah. Then I went to another company, a lottery management company, where I was employed as a sales rep, like a foot soldier. Within 8 months, 9 months, I was head of sales and marketing.
Wow. And what do you think made that, like, moving from the foot soldier to being head?
Well, I think it's the way you look at things.
Yeah.
You know, I was still young, and I think I wasn't, you know, I was so eager to succeed. And, you know, sometimes having a safety net changes your perspective on life. Mm-hmm. But when you don't have a safety net, you know, you look at things very differently. You know, you can't be as pompous. You can't be as cheeky. You work harder. You know that there's no one to catch me if I fall, right? So I think that's what made the difference. And then also, you know, I think this entrepreneur thing, you don't just get thrust into it. You have, it comes from a long way. The first thing I ever sold was balloons.
Oh, nice.
When I was 6, 7 years old.
Okay.
My dad went for a conference at Niagara Falls in Canada. Mm-hmm. When he was working for the embassy, he brought us this pack of balloons. Mm-hmm. So I went with the balloons to school. And then the kids were like, wow, these are so cool. Can I buy them off you? And then I said, how much? And I had a big pack. So I sold them. Then he was going for another conference. So I told him, I said, you know, I used to save my coins. And if you ask my brothers and sisters who are here, I used to pinder them. I'd say, I want my money, you know? I'll leave the little notes under the pillow that I need my money. 7 years old. Wow. And then I'll get the money. I gave that. Go buy me balloons. He brought a big pack, and I went and tripled my money at school.
Wow.
Yeah. So it comes a long way, this okay. entrepreneurship thing.
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, and then you mentioned safety net. One would think that your dad being a diplomat, you had a safety net. So
yeah, okay.
Tell us about that.
In a way, you could say that, but you know, he was a diplomat for about 9 years, then he came back to Zambia. bear in mind, this was during the Kaunda era.
Okay.
Yeah, so civil servants were not like as flashy as they are now.
You lose your job.
I mean, you had to explain if you had too many TVs in the house. You had to keep the receipts. So, so he worked in the civil service, and then obviously it was a big life change for myself, my parents, and my siblings to move from that life. And I started that life at kindergarten. I thought that was life. And then to come back and go into a house where water goes, power goes, it was so foreign. You know, I was wondering what is going on. What have I done wrong? Why am I being punished? So that also fueled me. I wanted to get back to the good, to the better life. You see what I mean? And then soon after that, my dad retired. And then, I realized that, okay, look, I've got to do something. I mean, people react differently. I mean, there are other people who, when you see that things have really gone bad, they lose hope.
Tell us now, after you worked in sales, what was the next step? What was the next thing you did after that?
I had a lot of jobs. I kept jumping jobs. I think I jumped 5 or 6 jobs. And at first, what I was telling myself was like, look, if I could get a salary of $1,000 a month, I'll be happy. Then I got $1,000. Then I said, no, if I got $2,000, I'll be happy. And it kept going on like that. And I didn't really have trouble getting a job.
Okay.
Because I'm good at sales. So people always want to increase their revenues. So I got a couple of jobs. I think I changed about 5 jobs. My last job, I think my salary was somewhere like $7,000 net.
Wow.
So, and I was young. I was in my 20s.
Wow.
So, I mean, that was a relatively good salary for someone of my age, right?
Yes.
But then I came and sat down and I thought, but I'm still not happy.
Somebody of any age.
Well, it depends where you shop.
That's it.
So then I realized, I said, I think the solution is not changing jobs. And then I think I had a boss who really got on my nerves. That also helped me make the jump. But I mean, even when I was working, I still used to get my hands into little things. You know, I'll do marketing promotions, I'd buy IT equipment and sell. I did a lot of things. I mean, when I was still at school, I used to, my sisters here, Veronica, I used to bake cupcakes and give it to sell to her workmates at Barclays, her and my other sister Martha.
Yeah.
And then I had these little girls. I don't know how many of you know what ice blocks are. I know you know what freezes are. I don't know what ice blocks are. So I used to make ice blocks. And then I'd make my cupcakes. And then I'd give my sisters to sell at their workplace. And my mom, my late mom, where she was working. And then the ice blocks, and 2 little girls would go sell at the market for me. Then they'll come at the end of the day, I'll knock off from school, I'll be home by 16. They'll come and cash in. And my sisters would bring the money. Then after supper, 3 hours, then I'll go do my baking and make my ice blocks freeze.
Wow.
Yeah, that's another sleep at about midnight every day.
Okay.
Yeah.
Wow, so that's an entrepreneur thing. Really started at an early age and you continued with it. Would you say it's a similar thing in terms of trying to find a job? I find that entrepreneurs believe they can make things happen, whereas even when they are looking for a job, even just having that made you not struggle to get any job because you won't believe that.
I think an entrepreneur is a certain beast which you need to understand. The animal that is an entrepreneur. You see, to be an entrepreneur, you need a certain amount of confidence. You even need to be slightly cocky. You know what I mean? If you're going to go in there and act all humble and everything, you're not going to get anywhere. It's the dog-eat-dog world out there. So, I see a lot of people, saying, I want to be an entrepreneur. I see young people saying, I want to marry a rich man or a rich woman. And I said, look, can you manage the personality of that person? You can't have it both ways. You can't have a kitty cat and expect it to go and hunt a buffalo, So if you are an entrepreneur and you're getting a lion, you know what I mean? We're strange people. We wake up in the middle of the night and write down ideas. You know what I mean? When we start working, we lose track of time. you know, if you're engrossed in what you're doing, you know. But I think an entrepreneur looking for a job, maybe if you said looking for a contract.
Business. Yes, so just dwelling on that for a little bit, because I'm trying to address both the issue of people saying it's very difficult to get a job, and then what other people don't struggle with that? What others would say.
Okay.
And then others again would be in a job and then wait for a promotion or wait for something to happen, but they're not delivering results. And you mentioned that you would deliver results if it was easier.
Yeah.
Does that matter?
I think a lot of people who work, they spend a lot of time whining, you know? And, I think they need to man up or woman up or whatever you want to call it. Yeah, and stop whining. You know, things you do today in your job have an effect on you later. You don't realize it. You never know who's watching what you're doing. So if you're working at 50% because you're frustrated or you're depressed, someone may notice. My first contract with Impact Media was from my former MD.
Wow.
She offered me a job when I came back. I was in Kenya. I came back, I started my company. Then she said, you know what? It was a few months, you look like you're struggling. We need a GM in Swaziland. And then I said, let me think about it. I went home and I was actually broke. I'll tell you about how broke I was. For those of you who think you need to have millions to start, I went home, I came back. I asked her, I said, empower me, don't employ me. She moved her advertising budget to me, about 40% of it. It was more than the salary I was getting. Now imagine if when I was working for her, I was a problematic employee, coming late, stealing, what?
Complain.
I would have bought that business.
Absolutely not.
Another partner of ours, Young and Rubicon, is managed by Peter Armstrong.
Yes.
I met Peter when I was, 24. Up to now, we're buddies. Up to now, we still do business together. Because of the relationship that was forged when I was working. So when I see people not giving it their all and just complaining, I mean, that's not really going to do anything.
Yeah, it doesn't help you in your current situation and won't help you in the future.
It won't help you in the future. Someone is paying attention to whatever you're doing right now.
Okay.
Yeah, and you may be either giving yourself an advantage or blocking yourself in the future.
Okay. And so you talked about your first job or your first contract when you started the Impact Media. Did you... Tell us about that shift from being an employee to starting now, going full-time.
Okay.
Entrepreneurship.
All right. You know, other people think it's not okay to say it, but I say it. I like money. it's a driving factor for me, right? And I've got no apologies because it has really made life nice.
Yes.
You get to take care of the people you love,
yes.
Right? And things that used to look like big problems don't seem so big anymore.
Absolutely.
You know what I mean?
Great. And you can now, you don't have to work with people you don't like. You got choice.
Yeah. No, having a bad boss is a blessing. He's helping you move on.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Okay. And people think that, I hate this guy. It's a blessing. You get to move on. Okay, the way I ended up starting Impact Media, like I told you, I used to do other little businesses and whatnot. If you ask my kids, they'll tell you, this man is always calculating something or writing something down or, you know. But I was working at DHL, so someone who's now my competitor, I won't mention the name, invites me for breakfast. And I think he wants business out of me, because at the time, we had no MD. So I was sort of like holding fort until the new MD came. I was head of commercial. So I go for this breakfast, and this guy's asking me about my qualifications, my experience, and what. And I'm wondering, you brought me here to get, but then he says, okay, let me just be honest, I'm interviewing you. We want you to go and be our business development manager for East and West Africa. So then I said, anyway, no, I mean, CHL is a very good company, and I was comfortable there. But then he just said, okay, can I have your email? And then he sent me the offer letter. And because I liked money, I took it. it was more than double what I was getting. So I took off. I went to Kenya. I was in Kenya, or East and West Africa, for about 11 months. I was moving through Tanzania, Uganda, Rwanda, and Ghana. I started seeing things. And then within 2-3 months of work, I was coming home for Christmas to come see the kids. And then my boss gave me $10,000. He says, you've made $2 million revenue for the company in 3 months.
Wow. Okay.
Additional. So he says, there's your bonus. Yeah. So then when I went there, I started seeing things. And then I was like, is it this easy? And I came back to Zambia and I could see the difference with West, East Africa, and Zambia. So I said, no, I need to come back. Then we weren't the best of friends with my bosses. So that also helped. And then they decided to retrench the regional manager's office.
Okay.
So they're like, we're going to make you general managers. Which was like basically a promotion. Right, and then I said, "Now, I mean, the general managers were reporting to me. You say you don't want it. I think let me go." He says, "Okay, no, you can go. Then you go." And he said, "Oh, fine, we'll go." I got like 11,000 dollars payout from them. Which, when I came back, I realized that what I'm about to do is going to be very hard. So I paid my rent for like 6-7 months. I paid electricity and cable for 6-7 months. I paid everything for 6-7 months. I had bought a Volvo, which I then reversed, and I bought a Toyota.
Mm-hmm.
And then I remained with about $5,000, which then I said, okay, no, fine. I'm going to use this money now to start up a business.
Okay.
We started up. We had 2 clients to begin with. And then I took part in some tenders. It was really hard those days. What I used to do some days when I don't have money, I'll go and see my sister S, and I'll tell her I don't have money. Mm-hmm. And she'll give me 50 kwacha. So I'll put 10 kwacha in one cell phone and 10 kwacha in the other one. Then 10 kwacha, I'll buy airtime for the fax machine, which was on my dining table. My dining table was my office.
Oh.
And then I put 20 kwacha fuel. And then you'd have to pick up the kids from school with that same 20 kwacha. So you'd have to make very calculated movements. Mm-hmm. You can't just like go back and forth, never. Like what my daughter does with her full tank.
You do this.
But I had to sweat it out because I know that, okay, I can only go and ask Ez for another 50 kwacha after 2 days. She's not going to listen to it again. So, you know, you had those challenges, but, you know, slowly, we had that tenacity. And, you know, you had clients who would say, we want to see your offices before we give you business. No, that's a terrible thing to say. If any of you are buyers, you should never say that. It's a terrible thing to say. Bill Gates started in a garage, so why should you be so hard on the next guy who's starting? You know? I mean, it's so bad. I went to my cousin's office and a friend's workshop twice and made it look like it was my office. And put it in my kids' lecture. I sat there waiting for them. I mean, you know, that's what desperation would do to you, because I needed the contract. You know what I mean? And there was no turning back this time. Because you know, like, ask any entrepreneur who's made it. You've tried maybe 20 businesses. There are very few try one and you succeed on the first one. So you find by the time someone is succeeding, you've tried about 50 different things. You get what I mean?
Yes.
Yeah, and then from there, then it just started picking up. We got one big tender. We won it. When I won it, I couldn't believe it. I went and sat down, had a cold glass of water, and then a Heineken. And I said, okay. No, I mean, you know, because everyone was like, want to see your office? And I had no office. Mm. My office was my car and the dining table.
Yeah.
Yeah. But then we got that one, and most of the money we pumped back. I borrowed some money from my sister, which I paid back with interest. The one smiling. And then My late mom loaned me $10,000, which she refused for me to pay back. She said that I'm planting a seed because I know you're gonna go far. So saying she didn't see what her seed has done. And then I have a friend, Amos. He also loaned me $10,000, which he also refused to get back. Yeah, there are not many friends like that. Yeah, and up to now he says, no, I never did it.
But he didn't. Really? Well.
Yeah, yeah. So from there, we just kept on turning the money. Maybe it's because I'm giving back, I don't know. Is it right? So we kept turning the money. You know, when people see entrepreneurs, all they see is a nice office, designer shirts, nice car. Those things don't really matter when you're starting, and they don't matter for a long time. It's like when you start, you know, people will come and tell you, you're so engrossed in trying to develop. People come and say, oh, well done, you're doing well. How does it feel to be rich? And then you're like, am I rich? You know, I swear, you don't know that you've made it. You're just pushing. You're just pushing, right? And then you know, then one day it hits you. It's like when you're losing weight or gaining weight. You don't
see it happening.
You don't see it happening. People come and tell you, oh, you know, you gained some weight, you've lost some weight. You only realize, you're the last person to realize it. And then at the end of it all, you're like, okay, I'm not really sure what rich is because I haven't reached where. I don't even have a point where I want to reach. I want to just keep growing. I don't think I'm rich, but anyway, now I've realized I'm not poor anymore. Yeah.
Excellent. I think that's a great story, a great feeling as well when somebody tells you and you see that your hard work and your humble beginnings paid off. I'd like you to talk more about that, where you scaled back when you were setting up, because I know even when I was coming here to set up Africa Trust Academy, somebody told me, driving a Toyota Corolla, you're not going to get business in Zambia. It was almost like you need to buy an inexpensive looking car in order to get business. Like,
well, I don't think that's really true, honestly, because I most of my clients who I've grown with, they met me driving a Corolla or a Camry or a Toyota Hilux van. Okay, the business that I'm in advertising, so impressions are important. You know, if I can't sell myself, how am I going to sell my clients? You get what I mean?
Yes.
So I must be appealing.
Yes.
I am a brand on my own. So if you can do that, then you know, then you're not going to get anywhere. I mean, it doesn't matter if you're an architect, a lawyer, or whatever you do. You cannot just rely on working business. You must be a salesman or saleswoman. You have to sell. If you don't know how to sell, business is not going to be that easy for you. Yeah, you have to learn how to sell. The issue of having a nice car and everything. I think, you know, perceptions are changing. I mean, if you look at the people here, I'm assuming they've come to hear a story and to get motivated or inspired, or whatever you want to call it. You know, traditionally, we're not people who help each other. I'm sure you're aware of that, yeah. But I mean, this shows me that, you know, people can support each other, you know, and their thinking is changing. I mean, I want to see a time where, you know, we've been seeing the same guys holding board of director positions from Kaunda days, the same old guys who really need to take a seat and rest, and, you know, it's the same thing. But because us young ones are fighting each other. So these old men, they continue to get their board fees and whatever. It's time I see Sandras as chairman of Standard Chartered Bank.
Impact Media.
Exactly. Holdings. I don't know what value someone who has been doing the same job for 40 years, what new thing they'll bring. And you see when the international companies come, they ask them, oh, who can we get as our board chairman? Or board? They're recycling the same guys. You know what I mean? And it has to stop. I mean, if it happened in other spheres of life, but not in business, you know, we have to shake that off. And it starts with us. I mean, I was very happy that you guys recognized me, you know, because I just work quietly and I didn't know that anyone is watching or wants to hear my story. But, it's quite humbling and, you know, motivating to know that there are other people who actually think what you're doing is good. Yeah. And we're the ones who are going to change things, you know what I mean? When I need something done, I'm going to say, okay, let me call Sandras. You know, I'm not going to call this an 85-year-old man. You know what I mean? You know, that has to stop. Yeah.
Brilliant. I think that what you're saying is really critical, and we're seeing that as well. Like from the time we started Grind in November last year, like the numbers have been growing, and we're seeing more and more people looking for inspiration, looking for connection, because entrepreneurship is lonely. Ask any entrepreneur, it's like you're just alone, and everybody says, why don't you get a job like everybody else? Well, you realize this. Not everybody else has got a job, and you meet people like this.
Well, I'll be honest, you know, I meet a lot of people in different spheres of life. I've met surgeons, I've met people working in, you know, lawyers, I've met, you know, senior accountants and whatnot. And those of you who are employers here, who think because I've given them a promotion or more money, or I've given them a personal loaner car, they're not that happy, these people. They actually want to work for themselves. It doesn't matter if you've made him a director. So long as he doesn't have a share of that business, these people actually want to, you know, branch out. I mean, I meet a guy and I'm in awe of him. And then, you know, he's like this super smart guy. And he tells me, he says, you know, so how's business? So what do you do? And so how did you start? And this guy is a brain surgeon. I'm like, really? You want to know what I'm doing? And then, you know, so I said, he says, yeah. And then I said, but I mean, you're this guy. And then he says, but you know what, I'm going to die with that. What legacy will I leave for my kids? I won't leave them my degrees, you know what I mean? And at the end of the day, I want to progress. I'm stuck here, you know what I mean? So every human being, you know, I think from the time, you know, through evolution, we're programmed to progress. We're all supposed to progress. When you stay stagnant, then, you know, I think some people think that if you have an employee, like the relationship I have with my employees, if you have an employee, you give them a car or whatever, you must make sure that they progress. That's why I encourage them to build. If they get a loan, if the loan is for building material, I'm all for it. That's why I let them get, you know, my two of my guys, they rent out like transport business. It does not conflict with my business. And he should have some extra money. You know what I mean? Because he's just like me. He also wants to take care of his family, which is important. When you realize that with your employees, you get more out of them because they value you. They realize that with this man, I can go somewhere. You know what I mean? I'm not stagnant. You know what I mean? And he's not greedy. He's not just looking at himself. I mean, I worked for one man once who didn't give us a Christmas bonus because he bought his son a brand new BMW. You can imagine. So, I mean, if you think like that, then your business won't go that far. But anyway, there are two words I'd like to say.
Yes.
For business, if you want to start your own business, first of all, humble yourself. Humble yourself, and then learn some discipline. Some of you here have got serious safety nets, be it your husband, your dad, your mom, your brother, you've got safety nets. I went into business, I had no one. If I didn't bring home bread, then we weren't eating. Some of you actually have safety nets and you're still scared. What are you scared of?
I think, yeah, actually I like what you said now, because it was going to be my next question. What advice would you give somebody that's scared to make the jump? Okay, so what are the other things that you think?
I can answer that question.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
The advice I'll give is that if you're working, start your business while you're working. And then set a buffer for yourself. Save some money. Don't expect to get money out of your business in the first 6 months to a year. If you can set a buffer, like what I did when I came and I paid my rent in advance, and I paid the school fees in advance, and I paid my utilities in advance. Do that. Don't quit your job and say, out of frustration, say, I'm going to start my own business. You know, decisions that are made out of emotion rarely yield results. So what you should do, set a buffer, give yourself a time frame. Because if you don't give yourself a time frame, you'll just keep procrastinating. And you're not going to get to where you want to get. So give yourself a time frame. Say, okay, my aim is to work myself out of a job in the next year. A lot of people who have made it And I've given this advice to other people. A lot of people go into the same business that they were working in. I mean, I did that as well. Usually, the easiest way is to really get a good relationship with some of those clients and move with them. Yeah. Just move with two good clients. That will keep you afloat.
Yes.
Yeah. That will keep you afloat in the interim.
Okay.
Yeah, that's what I would say. But don't just make a drastic jump unless you have no choice, unless you're forced to. But if you can avoid it, do it gradually. Give yourself a time frame. Set a safety net for yourself if you don't already have one. And like, you know, that your safety net could be your husband, could be your wife, you know, because you're supposed to be a team. So you're supposed to help each other.
Yeah.
Yeah. And they're the ones who are going to benefit from it anyway. But even when you stop, I'll tell you, when I stopped work, I had friends, I could hear little murmurs, friends, even relatives saying, how could he leave a regional job to come and start doing this nonsense? You know what I mean?
Yes.
But those same people say, I'm proud of you now.
Yes.
So, you know, you need to learn, like, okay, some advice I won't listen to, some I will.
Yes.
You know what I mean? But, you know, sometimes it's hard because maybe you have to ignore what your husband is saying, what your wife is saying, what your children are saying.
Yes.
But it's up to you, you know, it's your life. And you have to make your own mistakes. If you feel strongly about it, and you've planned it out, go for it.
Okay. Yeah. My next question now would be, looking on the Zambia entrepreneurship scene, what are your thoughts, looking at just nationally, in terms of people who want to start out, or their networks around, or government support, or any of those? What are your thoughts on that?
Well, I think one major challenge that startups and SMEs face, or let's say two, one is financing, and two is payments. I think the payment culture in Zambia is very bad. And it starts with the government. And that's why they can't control the corporates. Because there should be legislation in place. If they were not just paying lip service to know we want to support SMEs, this is the growth sector. If you really meant what you were saying, you would say companies that pay SMEs within 30 days, these are the benefits you get. Okay? Companies who pay SMEs within this time frame, you qualify for A, B, C, D, E, F, G. Okay? But you can't put such legislation in place when you're paying 120, 150 days. You see what I mean? So now, I think it's a bit harder now to start, because when you start, you may get some business, but because the cash flow is so bad, you may only be getting your first payment maybe 3 or 4 months down the line. And you know, with the volatility of our currency, it would have been eroded. Now, if your business is import based or relies on raw materials that are dollar based or foreign exchange based, you can imagine in 3 months the currency can go from 7.5 to 8.5. I mean, that's drastic. That kills about 10-12% of your margin. Now, assume you're pricing at 25%. That's half of your profit gone. Just in currency losses, you get that. So now, how do you hedge yourself against that? And then, you know, you're competing against people from other countries who are getting finance at 3%, 2%, 1%, right? And then you're playing anywhere between, depending where you're getting it from, 16 and 25%. You know, so it's really a tricky. It's not that easy. I think the government can do more. I think the banks can do more. I think the corporates, they can do more. They can pay better and sooner. I think what has happened is that because of the volatility of the currency, everyone's become a speculator now. We're like traders, all of us now. So like, if I get money into my business, I say, okay, I got 500,000 kwacha. Then I think, should I pay my suppliers? But I don't know when the next payment is coming from my clients. I may not be able to cover salaries, fuel, operating costs, rent, and whatever, or my leases. So let me hold on to this first, and then see. I'll pay when another payment comes up. So you're speculating. You're trying to, you know, give yourself a safety net. Now, a company like mine, which is now 10 years old, you know, we can take a few hits. But if you look at someone who's just a month old, you know, they may not be able to take those hits. So if you want to see more startups succeeding, I think, you know, we have to put certain things in place, and we need to stop giving lip service to promoting local entrepreneurs. Yeah.
I think I totally agree with you on that, and can relate that in South Africa, for example, the government has got a policy which they enforce where there's preferential procurement, where organizations and government buys from startups or from SMEs, and then also they pay early. And same, like, I totally agree. We worked with government in Zambia here and government in South Africa. Here, they took 3 months, 4 months to pay for something which it's a small amount, I mean, for for the government. But in South Africa, they'll pay within the same week.
Yeah.
And then still they get incentives, both the corporates and the government, which is great. So I totally agree. But what do you think we can do to actually make them do something about it? Because they know what needs to happen, and they talk about it, and everybody says, okay, if you vote for me, I'm going to do this, or if you vote for me, I'm going to change that. How about the people who are there, or who are the people we can talk to, or how can we make some real changes to happen, both government and corporates?
Well, I think that's a tough one. I think, you know, it depends on us. I mean, we have to change our attitudes first. We can't expect government to change. I'm sure here we've got people who work in banks, we've got accountants, maybe we've got CEOs here, we've got people working in government, we've got people who work for the mobile networks. Ask them why they hold payments. Ask them how. They should start themselves, because they will find these problems when they move from their jobs and go into their private sector. They will find another person like them. So they should start changing the culture in their companies. I mean, because there's no reason for a bank to owe you money for 60 days.
Yes.
Yeah, or someone who's in a cash business to owe you money for 90 days. They get their money right away.
I think you raised something which really bothers me. I know that every time going to companies, both whether it's private, government, parastatal, you meet somebody, you have a meeting, they say give you, bring a proposal, give them a proposal, then afterwards they say, don't forget and say. That loaded statement.
Oh yeah. Well, you're bound to run into that at some point.
How do you deal with that? And then also when they are holding your payment because they want you not to forget them. When 20% of your revenue just goes to people's pocket.
Well, actually, you know, there's this thing that I've noticed. It's not everywhere, but, you know, people try to be clever. You know, they try to make it seem, you know, maybe your check has just come out, it's followed all the procedures, your payment is ready. Then he says, you know, let me see what I can do, you know?
I'm pushing,
don't call me tomorrow, you know? I'm really trying to sort something out for you. No, okay, let's meet on Saturday. The check has been ready. When you check the date on the check, it's 2 weeks old, yeah? And then he says, you know, I've managed, you know what I mean? Ish, yeah, I had to push the other guys behind.
I didn't know checks were so heavy.
Apparently, yeah. Yeah, so, you know, you deal with characters like that, you know, who want to make themselves important, and that's why I say we have to change. The government's not going to change that.
And government is people. You're absolutely right. We usually blame the institution when the institution is made up of people.
Exactly. I mean, I have suppliers as well. If you ask my accountant, whenever we get, I think he's here, his name's John, you can ask him. When we get a payment, and I'll tell him, the first thing I do when we get a big payment, I said, can you send me an updated list of creditors? And then I'll say, can I have it aged? I don't want to be to favor someone, because you find that one person did work for you and told you 30 days, but because he wants to go to South Africa to watch football, he's calling you every 5 minutes. I say, I want to see the age analysis of the creditors, and I pay the ones which are fallen due. If you gave me 30 days, you're going to have to wait 30 days. You see what I mean? I don't need them to remind me, you see. And you know, sometimes when you go to a business, you see cars and you see people in the reception. I used to think this guy's got more business than me. Those are all people looking for their money. So the sign of a good businessman is an empty car park.
Yeah. Good. Thank you very much, Wally. And I think we can go on talking. I found this really, really interesting. And any last words? Not like you're dying or anything.
Well, I'd like to bequeath. Well, anyway, what I'll say is that, you know, I'm very grateful for the support you've all shown me and that you've come through here. I know you've got your families, you would have been at home with your kids and everything, but I'm very grateful you came through. And also, I'd like to encourage those of you who want to try and go on your own, start small, set a safety net, think it through, don't listen to your detractors, a lot of people tell you all sorts of things, just keep pushing, you know, if the first one fails, it's not the end of the world.
Correct me if I'm wrong, but what I've noticed is that most of our entrepreneurs in Zambia, they start up their business quite well and they pick up and maybe at some point they really go down. Others actually even shut down completely. I don't know what it's going to take for us to be able to grow our businesses to a level where it goes international, for example. What would the problem be?
Well, I think, you know, I don't think that any two managers can give the same results. You can put me and Sandra as MDs of the same company, we're going to give you different results. So I wouldn't like to, you know, just like generalize it that all Zambian entrepreneurs end up like that. I mean, there are stories of people, you know, who get their first payment and go and buy a Range Rover, you know. But that's lack of discipline, you know. You know, some of these things, you realize when it's time to do them, you know, certain expenditure, you realize when you don't have to strain to do it. When you don't have to strain to do it, then you know that, okay, fine, I'm ready to do this. What causes a lot of businesses to go down? There are a number of factors. I had mentioned cash flow. A lot of entrepreneurs will tell you, you know, the haphazard cash flows, the poor payment culture, it really wreaks havoc on us, you know. And so when you're starting out, you may look like you're doing well, then you end up going down. I know a lot of businesses have got a lot of debt, that the interest rates also have an effect on them. So, you know, as time goes on, it becomes insurmountable. It, you know, it pressures them so much that they buckle under the pressure and they fold. Other people, maybe it's they're bullied out by foreigners, foreign companies. I don't want to mention countries. I don't want to seem biased, but I mean, you know, in other countries, let's say for South Africa as an example, they've got protected industries which are just for the locals to participate in, right? And then you get certain ratings if you pay on time and such things. That is real support to SMEs and to startups, which we don't have here. You find that I'll be bidding against a Chinese firm or a Lebanese firm, or I said the countries anyway. I'll be bidding against a Chinese or Lebanese firm. Their permit is to make mattresses or curtains or beddings. Why am I bidding advertising against the guy who's got a permit to make mattresses? That's what he came here for. Let him do that. You know, why am I bidding against a Chinese guy to do billboards for the government when he came here as a medical doctor or as a contractor? They didn't do what he came to do. They're not protecting us, so they're leaving us, you know, to fight against these guys. And then these guys are getting funding at 1-2%. And then, you know, so this is why probably, you know, I'm very skeptical about getting loans and whatnot. I think that's what has helped us survive. We have just been rolling over our own money. We get the money, we roll a portion of it back into the business. And then the business has been growing like that. If that money was borrowed, I can do that job, you know? Mm-hmm. Look at it, I can do that. When you stop updating your CV and stop looking at the back pages, then you know that now I'm gone. Yeah. And there's no turning back now.
correct me if I'm wrong, but what I've noticed is that most of our entrepreneurs in Zambia, they start up businesses quite well, and they pick up, and maybe at some point they really go down. Others actually even shut down completely. I don't know what it's going to take for us to be able to grow our businesses to a level where it goes international, for example.
Well, I think, you know, I don't think that any two managers can give the same results. You can put me and Sandra as MDs of the same company, we're going to give you different results. So I wouldn't like to, you know, just like generalize it that all Zambian entrepreneurs end up like that. I mean, there are stories of people, you know, who get their first payment and go and buy a Range Rover, you know. But that's lack of discipline, you know. You know, some of these things, you realize when it's time to do them, you know, certain expenditure, you realize when you don't have to strain to do it. When you don't have to strain to do it, then you know that, okay, fine, I'm ready to do this. What causes a lot of businesses to go down? There are a number of factors. I had mentioned cash flow. A lot of entrepreneurs will tell you, you know, the haphazard cash flows, the poor payment culture, it really wreaks havoc on us, you know. And so when you're starting out, you may look like you're doing well, then you end up going down. I know a lot of businesses have got a lot of debt, that the interest rates also have an effect on them. So, you know, as time goes on, it becomes insurmountable. It, you know, it pressures them so much that they buckle under the pressure and they fold. Other people, maybe it's they're bullied out by foreigners, foreign companies. I don't want to mention countries. I don't want to seem biased, but I mean, you know, in other countries, let's say for South Africa as an example, they've got protected industries which are just for the locals to participate in, right? And then you get certain ratings if you pay on time and such things. That is real support to SMEs and to startups, which we don't have here. You find that I'll be bidding against a Chinese firm or a Lebanese firm. Oh, I said the countries anyway. I'll be bidding against a Chinese or Lebanese firm. Their permit is to make mattresses or curtains or beddings. Why am I bidding advertising against the guy who's got a permit to make mattresses? That's what he came here for. Let him do that. You know, why am I bidding against a Chinese guy to do billboards for the government when he came here as a medical doctor or as a contractor? Let him do what he came to do. They're not protecting us, so they're leaving us, you know, to fight against these guys. And then these guys are getting funding at 1-2%. And then, you know, so this is why probably, you know, I'm very skeptical about getting loans and whatnot. I think that's what has helped us survive. We have just been rolling over our own money. We get the money, we roll a portion of it back into the business. And then the business has been growing like that. If that money was borrowed money, our story was going to be very different. For us to go international, it's also another challenge, because you find that most businesses are either agents or are supplied by people outside. So it's a bit tricky in that it's hard for you to compete with your supplier, you know. And in those markets, like I've told you, like South Africa, you find, you go there, you say, okay, I want to go into outdoor advertising and branding. They'll tell you this is reserved for locals. So how do you penetrate there? You won't even be able to register your business. You get what I mean? Whereas here, we don't have that protection. It's free for all, you know what I mean? And the worst part is, I don't even blame government. I blame ourselves. You know, we should be proud to say, let's support each other. Let's push each other forward, you know. I think that's the difference between a person with a loser mentality and a winner. Whenever someone comes, whoever you are, I mean, if you ask my employees or even my kids, anyone could just walk into my office, and they'll tell them, like, no, first wait, let me ask him if he can see you. I don't even know why my lady does that, because I always say, let them in. You know what I mean? And I hear the story, and everyone has got a different story. Some people just want inspiration. Some people want help. Some people want you, they'll just come, I want to do this, how do I do it? Or can you support me? Some people actually want you to invest in their idea and help them push them forward. And we do that, and we do try and help them. I wish everyone can start thinking like that. Then we'll get out of this rut that we're in. Yeah, we can't keep blaming other people.
Good evening, everybody. My name is Dabo. I want to find out, how are you finding the competition with the SA companies coming here in regards to billboards?
Yeah.
And also, I want to find out, what's the next big step for Impact Media and yourself as well? Thank you.
Well, the competition is definitely there. We don't have the figures, but maybe I would say, in the industry, maybe we're number 4 or 5 or 4, somewhere there, right? And considering, like, if you go to the register, we're over 50 of us. It's not too bad. The foreign companies, actually, 2 of them have tried to buy me out. Twice. Yeah. One 6 months into operation. The last one was like 2-3 months ago. 2-3 years ago, sorry. But that deal never went anywhere. It's a bit different. With the local guys, I mean, I appreciate their efforts and they're pushing and they're trying to take care of business and their families and whatnot. But, I'm proud to say that as Impact Media, I think I only know of maybe 1 or 2 other guys who have imported structures. We started making our own structures 9-10 years ago. We import structures from the same suppliers as the 2 biggest players. So I think we're trying. I mean, we don't have a head office where we can get funding or whatever, you know, low-cost funding. But I think, you know, in our own little way, we've tried to, you know, keep up with them. I'm sure they can feel my breath on their neck. Yeah. So we've tried to hold fort, but obviously, I mean, these are big companies, you know, they're owned by venture capitalists sitting somewhere in New York. These guys have got very deep pockets, you know what I mean? So it's not as easy. I mean, hence the reason why they tried to buy me out twice. It was probably just someone's bonus that they offered me, you know? Yeah, so, yeah, and the next thing for Impact Media, well, I'm glad to say we've grown year on year, although this year, if you're calculating real value, like in foreign currency with the devaluation, I don't know, but we're still pushing. We're still pushing. I always refer to my kids, I tell them, I said, everyone has to push, you know. We don't get any slackers. If Joanna can push, has to push. So I go to work, Daddy has to push, everyone has to push. So we have to get forward. So long, when I take stock of what I've done in December, I should be at least 2 or 3 steps further on than where I was when I started in January.
Thanks.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Jessie Mogo. I would like to find out what your strategy is for continuing the business when you are gone. Yeah. And then I would also like to know what exactly you do in terms of how you differentiate the roles that you play as the owner of the business, the workers that you have, and of course your involvement, the involvement of your family members in your business, that is your children and your wife. Because there's a tendency for these businesses to die when the owner of the business is gone.
Okay. If you talk to my kids, they'll tell you that that the language he uses is like it's in me, you know. I talk about business because that's what I know. You know, if you're a doctor, you'll talk about medicine. If you're a banker, you'll talk about people defaulting and whatever. If you're a teacher, you talk about your students. You know, I want to get this one clear. You know, in Zambia, we have this belief that, oh, if I'm talking about what I'm doing, which is business, and I'm excited about a new contract or a new project, they assume that, you know, you're too proud of yourself or you think you're special or whatever. They need to understand that that's what's in your head and that's what you think. So I've had my friends come over home and say, is that how you talk to your kids? And my son will be like, oh, Dad, so has that deal gone through? And what, you know what? And we engage. And this has been happening since they were tiny. Yeah, because that's my life. You get what I mean. As for involvement of family members in my business, I don't have any family member who works in my company. My kids have come and done a bit of work when they're on holiday, but they don't really work, and they're not even at school here, so they don't really work there. But I've tried to introduce them to the business. Usually if they ask for something like an expensive phone, just as a life lesson, come and work, get your pay, and see if you can buy that phone. Yeah. Yeah. But my daughter, the firstborn, she's doing civil engineering, and we're ever getting civil engineers as consultants at my company for installations and things like that. So I'm happy about that. My son is doing his O's next year, and he wants to do business studies, but he changes every 2 months. I don't know if he's going to change again. But he says he wants to do creative studies so that he can do an ad agency, then we can partner with Impact, and then he will carry on the flame. My daughter, the one that was just sitting on my lap, she also changes every now and then, but I have a feeling that she's going to be a business manager. Although she doesn't know it yet, but I think she will be. You know, she's got that personality. She's a people person, and people only buy from people they like. Yes. And everyone likes Joanna. So I think she'll do it. Yeah.
Thanks. There was a question, Joe.
Good evening, everyone. I just have one quick question. On your profile, I read you spoke about how you balance your business interests and real estate investment. How would you advise someone that wants to invest into real estate, and how profitable is it compared to the business you're already doing? Investing is that on the side.
I have a love for real estate, and it stems from the fact that the quality of property in Zambia is compared, like on an international level, it's like below par. And also we have a deficit. I don't have the figures, but it's a big deficit. So you find that property in Zambia is well overpriced. So my projection or my feeling is that the next 10 to 15 years, I don't think you can make a loss for property. I mean, you can tell if you've just tried to buy land that our property is extremely overpriced. Or even if you just try and buy a simple rundown house, you'll be surprised at the price that the people are asking for that house. So, because it's not managed properly, and I'll say that because it's true. The towns are not planned properly. They don't regulate things properly. And because of that, you know, we have that confusion, and you know, it's a very good property. It's a very good safety net. It appreciates at an amazing rate. It's a way of keeping your wealth intact. You know, the more property you have or assets you have, you know, you sort of hedge yourself against these currency fluctuations and depreciations in our currency and so on. You know, I don't really take the property business as a core business. It's like an idle business, or, you know, passive income. Yeah, that's the word I was looking for. It's like a passive income, but it's a very good passive income if you get it right. Yeah, but I would encourage anyone to do that. But you know, you have to balance between what property are you developing and where are you developing it, and what the market requires. You know, my first project, I think I went a bit overboard, and you know, I was learning and so on, but it's good. Now I know, you know, how to get a higher return per square meter, because that's what you should be aiming for. Yeah.
90% international, and I had no problem with just doing straight business, going out, getting sales, bringing people to this country. I moved to Lusaka, I've got involved in a number of businesses down here, and it seems like little brown envelopes is the norm, and it's a real problem. And we were talking about, is the government going to stop this? Clearly it's not, and it's down to the people who are in the business sector to stop this. But I reckon one of the businesses that we have about 80% of the doors closed, and it's actually in the creative business, we have about 80% of the doors closed because we actually have it on our website, but it says corporate policy, and you go to that page, it says we don't get kickbacks. But that closes 80% of the doors in this city, roughly. How do you think this is ever going to change? Because it is a real problem for successful and healthy growth of business in this country.
Well, it is something, I mean, any businessman who tells you that they've never come across it, and they would be lying. You will come across it. But I think it differs the industry. You know, some industries it's a bit more than others, and others it's a bit less. I mean, I've had situations where, because I sell advertising space, and I'd like to think all of my sites are prime sites. I've had a situation where someone was literally trying to bleed me, and then I just put my foot down and I said, you know what? This is a very prime site. I don't need to give a kickback to sell this site. I'm actually going to give it to your competitor. And I gave it to the competitor. And although I closed that door, but I mean, sometimes you have to do it. You have to take a stand. Because, you know, these people don't even understand how much margin you make. Maybe you're making 30% or 20%. And he says, I want 10%. So how do we share? I've got overhead. I've got employees and whatnot. You know, so it's a tricky thing. I wouldn't like to say that it's entrenched everywhere, but it is entrenched everywhere. So I think, you know, the only thing you can do is, like, you know, maximize on your service, innovation, do something different, you know, such that they can't ignore you. I had people who, when I was starting, just decided I'll never give this guy business. Whether it's because I didn't give them a kickback or they just didn't like my face, I don't know. But they are there, and they hate you, like, with a passion. And, you know, and you're even wondering, what did I do? You know, so you find like those people. I actually said something to a friend of mine. I said, I'm going to work until they can no longer ignore me. I'm going to work until they can no longer ignore me. They will phone me one day and say, can you do this for us? There was a client who actually, I came up with like a new type of structure. I gave it to their competitor and the other competitor. They went to my competitor and said, can you make the same thing that he made and do it for us? That's how badly they didn't want to give me the business. And you know, I wonder what makes someone do that. But I guess people are different. So, you know, although you find that, I think there's some things you can do which will make them not be able to ignore you. I don't know if you're in the same industry, if you're in the hospitality industry, but if you are, I think things have changed. You know, the middle class has grown, and we've got more people with more disposable income now. You can go direct to individuals, and an individual will not ask you for a kickback. The most I'll say is, okay, I'm coming to stay at your lodge or your safari park. Can I get a group discount because I'm coming with my family?
90% international, and I had no problem with just doing straight business, going out, getting sales, bringing people to this country. I moved to Lusaka, I've got involved in a number of businesses down here, and it seems like little brown envelopes is the norm. And it's a real problem. And we were talking about, is the government going to stop this? Clearly it's not, and it's down to the people who are in the business sector to stop this. But I reckon one of the businesses that we have about 80% of the doors closed, and it's actually in the creative business. We have about 80% of the doors closed because we actually have it on our website, but it says corporate policy, and you go to that page and it says we don't get kick out. But that closes 80% of the doors in this city, roughly. How do you think this is ever going to change? Because it is a real problem for successful and healthy growth of business in this country.
Well, it is something, I mean, any businessman who tells you that they've never come across it, and they would be lying. You will come across it, but I think it differs the industry. You know, some industries it's a bit more than others, and others it's a bit less. I mean, I've had, situations where, because I sell advertising space, and I'd like to think all of my sites are prime sites. I've had a situation where someone was literally trying to bleed me, and then I just put my foot down and I said, you know what? This is a very prime site. I don't need to give a kickback to sell this site. I'm actually going to give it to your competitor. And I gave it to the competitor. And although I closed that door, but I mean, sometimes you have to do it. You have to take a stand because, you know, these people don't even understand how much margin you make. Maybe you're making 30%. Or 20%, and he says I want 10%. So how do we share? I've got overhead, I've got employees and whatnot, you know. So it's a tricky thing. I wouldn't like to say that it's entrenched everywhere, but it is entrenched everywhere. So I think, you know, the only thing you can do is, like, you know, maximize on your service, innovation, do something different, you know, such that they can't ignore you. I had people who, when I was starting, just decided I'll never give this guy business. Whether it's because I didn't give them a kickback or they just didn't like my face, I don't know. But they are there, and they hate you, like, with a passion, and, you know? And you're even wondering, what did I do, you know? So you find, like those people. I actually said something to a friend of mine. I said, I'm going to work until they can no longer ignore me. I'm going to work until they can no longer ignore me. They will phone me one day and say, can you do this for us? There was a client who actually, I came up with like a new type of structure. I gave it to their competitor and the other competitor. They went to my competitor and said, can you make the same thing that he made and do it for us? That's how badly they didn't want to give me the business. And you know, I wonder what makes someone do that. But I guess people are different. So, you know, I feel that although you find that, I think there's some things you can do which will make them not be able to ignore you. I don't know if you're in the same industry, if you're in the hospitality industry, but if you are, I think things have changed. You know, the middle class has grown, and we've got more people with more disposable income now. You can go direct to individuals, and an individual will not ask you for a kickback. The most I'll say is, okay, I'm coming to stay at your lodge or your safari park. Can I get a group discount because I'm coming with my family? Which, I mean, discounts are a gift, and we have no problem with that, you know. So. Maybe, but
to be honest, this isn't the hospitality. This isn't the advertising industry. So it's Mojo New Media.
Oh, okay,
yeah.
Okay,
so
okay.
I'm a partner there, but also I'm a partner in Best of Bikes.
Okay.
Selling motorbikes.
Oh yeah.
And we tender.
Oh yeah. Yes, I understand. I've stopped tendering because it just ties up my money in big securities and big bonds. It takes a long time to prepare. And you find that, you know, although the aim is to get the best bid, you know, someone will knock you out on a very small technicality just because he wants the business to go to someone else. And I think it's irrational. And I think ZPPA needs to look into that. It's so ridiculous. You know, we spend so much time, so much money on tenders. I just said, look, if you're going to give it to a guy who's not even in the industry, you give it to a guy who does something completely different. Then I think just do that. I'm not going to waste my time and energy taking part in the tender. Because I said, no, let me just focus on person-to-person interaction. When you have too much trouble with the juniors, go over their head. go and talk to the decision makers, go talk to their boss. Yeah. No, I mean, you shouldn't feel bad about it. They've asked for it, so just go over there.
Yeah. We've had a lot of feedback, so we know which organizations are known for corruption. Say, oh, don't even deal with us because you start paying everybody, starting from the cleaner all the way. Like by the end of the day, it's not worth it. But so we research things, and our company collects all that feedback, the good feedback and the bad feedback. So the organizations that we work with say, look, your reputation is so bad that even suppliers now say you need to pay upfront before we deal with you. Now you struggle. We find that those organizations really have to spend a lot more money because their trust is so bad. But I think the good thing is just for us to continue talking about it and to have the courage to whistleblow and to talk. And finally, they'll be a little bit shy as opposed to so blatant, say, you should never forget me, or so what are you going to do for me, or what can you do so we push this? So, yeah.
But I think that, to be honest, to be fair, the problem is more with the men. Women is not such a big problem. You know, they're actually scared.
Yeah.
They're actually scared. Yeah. So when I hear that the new head of marketing is a woman, I even go, thank you. But although they're tougher,
these
guys don't smile.
Well, thank you very much, Wally. A big hand for Wally. It's been a great, great chat. And I'd like to thank everybody for coming up to Startup Grind Lusaka. Thank our sponsors once again, Zona, Transactions, African Trust Academy, Fortress Media, Samoj Photography, Portico for sponsoring the food and drinks. Capesa's new concept for them. Bashupa's wonderful makeup. And the next event is going to be the last Thursday of September. And we've got a great speaker that's lined up as well. This video will be uploaded on startupgrind.com/Lusaka. So we're here for the next few minutes. I'll invite all of you to stay now to network, and there's some food and drinks. If the free food and drinks finishes, you can buy some food and drinks. But it's time now to just mix and ask other people questions. And I'd like to recognize the presence of Joko, the lady that asked the last question. She's shareholder director for ProFlight and Mojo Media. But she's also a seasoned entrepreneur that you can learn a lot from. Thank you very much.